chicken barbecue dinner yesterday, plus many thanks to those church family members and friends who came out to buy them in support of our church fundraising program. And we really appreciate all your special commitment despite the pretty, you know, challenging by the COVID-19 pandemic, but with your strong commitment to God that you have come to worship with us in God's house in person. That is pretty challenging. Everyone, your faith, but you have made it. I appreciate for your steady commitment and even the sacrificial heart you have shown to God whom we worship today. And since we follow the restriction guideline of New York State, we avoid having the Holy Communion during this COVID-19 pandemic. And we also prohibit or avoid passing around our offering plates during this time, period of time. Instead, the congregation is invited to come forward, the family by family, to put their offerings in the offering plates placed in the front of the sanctuary, keeping social distance while the offertory music is presented by our church meeting choir. And also, the congregation is expected to remain seated while we sing congregational hymns, you know, hymns along with our meeting choir, who will be leading the opening as we did for the opening hymns. So you can join us even by, you know, singing a video face mask. In addition, we don't take any piece of paper to collect the prayer concerns for the same reason during the opening hymn. Instead, please send your prayer concerns, if you have, to the church office by email or phone call by Wednesday morning. Particularly, our special thanks to Gar Burdett, who is our church custodian, for his wonderful effort, great effort, to keep our whole sanctuary and facilities, particularly our worship place, sanitized constantly by his cleaning work for the safety of our church worshiping person, so that everyone may feel safe when they come to worship Sunday morning. Do you have any?
Yes. Okay. I hope everyone enjoyed our worship video that we've been doing since March. I thought you might enjoy seeing a behind-the-scenes video, better known as a blooper video, that Kathy and Jim are going to play. I wish we could see it. We can't see it. But anyway, Isabel will be putting this blooper video on the website later on.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
praise your wonderful deeds which you have done through your Son Jesus Christ. And also we want to commend your great works, wonderful deeds to another generation by speaking of your mighty work. And also we pray for a great place we love to always take care and always keep holy, because you are holy God upon us. May it enable us to keep ourselves always consecrated by Spirit through our worship, so that we may open new week granted by your expectation to move forward with all your powerful presence. We may never fear anything, because we believe you fulfill your promise as our protector. We ask you to take all our offered hearts and our worshiping spirit from the beginning to the end through our dedication. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. And everyone says, Amen. Let us prepare our gifts and thanks, and you can follow the guide of our ushers.
Thank you.
to be enough, good enough to be wonderful witnessing testimony to everyone. We ask you to accept this offering that reflects our great thanksgiving. We pray in Jesus' name.
I want Jesus to walk with me.
Three longtime close friends are shipwrecked on a deserted island. They have been there for quite a while. One day, Mask Land washes up on the shore and they find it. One of them begins to rub the lamp, and sure enough, a genie pops up. The genie says that he will grant each one of them one wish apiece. The first guy says, "I have really missed my wife's cooking. I wish I could be back at home ready to eat one of her great, meals." The genie waves his hands and poof, the man is sitting at the table in his house ready to eat delicious dinner. The second man says, "You know what, I've never been married, but I really miss my girlfriend. I wish I was on my way to her house to pick her up for a date." The genie waves his hands and poof. The second man is driving his car on the way to pick up his girlfriend for a date. The third man says, "I'm really glad those two guys got what they wanted, but I sure do miss them all. I wish they were back here with me again." So was the wish of the third man granted, and the other two guys came back where they were before, totally wondering what happened to their wish come true life. Imagine this morning with me that you can have anything you want. You know, you want riches? Ask for it. You want a long and healthy life? All you have only to do is ask God, who would grant all your wishes like the genie who popped out from the lamp. The question is, what do you think you would fear by the time you reach the end of your journey of life? There once was a man who was asked this very question by God himself. His name was Solomon, and he became king of Israel after his father David had died. Solomon was probably about 20 years, pretty young, young adult, 20 years old, when he was asked this question. "Ask for whatever you want me to give you," said God. If we were Solomon, wouldn't we be thinking about how nice it would be to have a much higher paying job, a better house, nice car? Particularly, we want to be a mega million, lottery winner. But you know what Solomon asked for? He asked for wisdom and discerning hearts between good and evil, between right and wrong. And in today's Old Testament text, we see God so pleased with such a young guy, Solomon, for choosing wisdom. So God said to him, "Since you have asked for this and not for long life or wealth for yourself, nor have asked for death of your enemies, but for discernment in administering justice, I will do what you have asked, and I will give you also what you have not asked for, both riches and honor, so that in your lifetime you will have no equal among kings." So did God keep his promise as proved in history. But the point of today's message is not how much wealthy he was, but how he felt later, at the end of his life, which was full of riches and honor he could offer in this world. Now let's flash forward. You come to see the end of Solomon's life. What kind of life do we think Solomon had? With those bountiful riches and health and wealth, wouldn't we expect it to be a happy and joyful life? Solomon wrote Ecclesiastes later in his life. It is a book where we see Solomon looking back and contemplating how his life was being spent and how he concluded his life at the very end of his journey of life. You remember what he concluded? Vanity of vanities. All is vanity. As we know, King Solomon began his reign when he was a young king. He reigned as a humble servant of God, seeking God's word, seeking God's wisdom, and seeking God's help. But as he grew older, with more riches, more comfort, his heart began to turn away from God, to many gods of the many wives he had taken from foreign land. Do you know how many wives he had? He had 700 wives and 300 concubines. You can see whether my account is right, my saying is right. 1 Kings chapter 11, 1. Solomon's later years were miserable because God removed his hand of blessing. Yet he maintained the Solomon throne only because of his promises to his father David. In the book of Ecclesiastes, which Solomon wrote near the close of his life, reflecting on life's experiences and the lessons he had learned, the word vanity, V-A-N-I-T-Y, vanity appears 43 times in separate 28 verses. And this is one of the key words in his book, vanity. All vanity, it's always vanity. Vanity, the word vanity means something without substance. Something without real substance. People think they grabbed many substances through success of their career and their business. Yet they will realize by the time they reach the end of their life, those are nothing but morning mist, which quickly disappears along with their death. That is not your substance that lasts and endures to eternity. King Solomon tried what satisfaction might be found in his wealth and his pleasure, pleasure of the world, and at last pronounced that apart from God, all is vanity. Nothing but vexation. This message of Ecclesiastes is still a practical and valuable message for us today, particularly young generation of this country. Not only this country, even Asian countries, South Korea, Japan, and Chinese. In his autobiography, Just As I Am, Billy Graham recalls a story demonstrating that apart from God, we will not gain anything from life. He said, some years ago, Ruth, my wife, and I had a vivid illustration of this on an island in beautiful Caribbean. One of the wealthiest men in the world had asked us to come to his lavish home for lunch. He was 75 years old, and throughout the entire meal, he seemed close to tears. I'm the most miserable man in the world, he said to Billy Graham. Out there is my yacht. I can go anywhere. I have my private plane, my helicopter. I have everything I want to make my life happy. down to the hill to a small cottage where my wife Ruth and I were staying. That afternoon, the pastor of the local Baptist church came to call. He was an Englishman, and he too was 75 years old, but a widower who spent most of his time taking care of his two invalid sisters. He was full of enthusiasm and love for Christ and others. He said, "I don't have £2 to my name," he said with a smile, "but I am the happiest man on this island, Caribbean island," he said. Billy Graham relates how he asked his wife Ruth after they left, "What do you think is the richer man?" Of course, she didn't have to reply because both of them knew already the answer. Then the point is this, Billy Graham said, when we examine our life in the end of our journey, what do we think we would find? Vanity? What real substance that will endure even beyond our death to eternity? In the day of Jesus, there was a great multitude of the same kind of people following Jesus. But they were looking forward to getting from Jesus the bread by which their body would be satisfied. Yet this bread corrupts, spoils as fast as human satisfaction does. Do you think our satisfaction after we fall to something great will last? No, it doesn't last. So, this bread corrupt as fast as human satisfaction does. So, Jesus advises the people who followed him only for the physical and temporal benefits and not for the satisfying of their inner hunger. Living in today's consumer society, fueled by sophisticated advertising and relative affluence, we have been given the means and motivation to pursue countless forms of bread. If I simply possess a nice-looking, expensive car or computer, my self-image will be healed. And my sense of safety and well-being renewed. Once we possess those things, then what happens next? Of course, their seductive appeal evaporates. And we move into a new target of gratification. That's human nature. We Christians are not exempt from the seductions of the material culture around us in such a blessed, bountiful, you know, Latin America. We define the bread we need with lives of remarkable indulgence, gadgets. All kinds of gadgets made out of latest computer technology and luxuries with the glitter and glamours, you know, enticing Christians to spend much money and energy to obtain them. That is why it is very crucial and significant for us to keep, you know, spiritual values foremost in our minds, always ahead of material possessions. For instance, we have been putting all of our energies into getting ahead in this world while neglecting heavenly values, like the multitudes who were seeking Jesus for the same purpose. So Jesus said, "Do not labor for the food that perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life." The people were looking for Jesus, but they were looking not for the right reason. They did not know what they really needed because they could not lift their minds above the material blessing, above material bounty, above worldly fashions and values. But how did Jesus define the real blessed life in his beatitude? Blessed are those who are hungry. They will be satisfied. They are hungry and thirsty for righteousness, because God will satisfy their inner hearts, inner souls. That is real blessed life. Yes, when we realize that we are spiritually hungry, we need to acknowledge it and let our main quest of life be for the imperishable. Imperishable, which will satisfy our inner souls. Never feeling vanity, never feeling empty at the end of our journey of life. Yet on verse 28, the followers of Jesus still could not understand Jesus' point, for they did not realize that they were spiritually hungry, neither did they need to acknowledge their hunger. So they said to Jesus, "What shall we do so that we may do God's work?" Their questions implies a feeling of self-sufficiency. The feeling is self-righteousness, self-complacent, being the bounty for possessions. They seem confident that they could do God's work with what they hold, what they possess, with knowledge, with the materials God has given into their hands. They think they could do God's work, yet Jesus challenged them to expand their life for the imperishable food, which is the bread of heaven, Jesus Christ, who came to offer a real food that will never perish, never rot, never spoils, but endures to everlasting life. And there will be satisfying our inner souls. There will be quenching our thirsty souls. Therefore, in verse 29, Jesus replies to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in the one whom he has sent." In a word, the basic work for God is having faith in Jesus and helping our family members and other friends also to believe in the one whom God has sent for their salvation and their eternal life. They didn't understand that it is not our role of their works and their labors, but it is a gift from God. Sincere believers are puzzled about what God wants them to do. The religions of this world attempt to answer this question, but Jesus' reply was very simple. We must believe in the one whom God has sent. That is God's work. Satisfying God does not come from the labors we do, but out of whom God has sent, and we believe it. Therefore, the first step is to accept Jesus, just as claimed by Peter, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Then embark on a life of this belief that will be satisfying your Creator, God. Because apart from God, apart from living for the will of God, there is ultimately nothing left in the end of the journey but vanity. Just as Solomon concluded, just as the billionaire who invited Billy Graham to his luxurious place in Caribbean. Let me come to the conclusion. Yes, apart from God, we do not gain anything from life, neither do we understand the meaning and purpose of life. But God created man for fellowship with him first. Just like Adam and Eve had with their creator God in the Garden of Eden prior to their fall. Only by our close communion with God through Jesus, our inner souls and hearts will be happy and satisfied that the food that never spoils but endures to everlasting life, even beyond our death on this earth. That is the food Jesus is talking about. And that is the food Jesus is telling you and me to work for through the life of our family, our career, our church community as well. And you can say amen.
And now in the grace of the Father, our loving Father, and the wonderful love of the Son Jesus Christ, and the continuing fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you, now and forever.